Yeah. Greed is the root of all evil. In the days before violence was senseless and counterproductive, there were three young friends who were not to be fucked with. Inner city thugs, what? Rough Riders. Vancouver after losing the Stanley Cup Riders. Thriving on chaos, anarchistic, hedonistic, auto-cannibalistic. Like a wolf licking a blade, stuck in the ice, thinking it's getting a taste. Lifeblood slipping away, I'm talking bad boys. Throwing dice in the ghetto, drinking liquor like it was a sacrifice to the devil. Dancing, gambling, getting money illegally, do nothing but extortion and thievery. I mean, these guys were badasses, women with bad lashes at them, but mostly only for cash transactions. Yeah, that happens. You can hate it or love it, but if you hate it, then you're probably not acquainted with thugging. I'm not saying it's right, I'm just saying it's real. If you're chasing a thrill, it's probably making you feel good, like taking a pill. And these guys were thrill-seeking, just three friends, getting ill every weekend. Now I know what you're thinking, typical gangster rappers, but these guys were Belgians, from medieval Flanders. Think boys in the hood, think menace to society, just from the Middle Ages, of the Flemish variety. That's a human universal, groups of aggressive men. We get it from Adam and Eve, from original sin. That's why people have these appetites, and that's why Christ had to be sacrificed, because of Adam's apple bites. It's tragic, right? Jesus' body torn to pieces just cause Adam and Eve were so naughty. But too much preaching will leave you actively snoring, so I'll keep things moving and we'll go back to the story. It starts at a tavern one morning where those three thugs were still having a stab at a party. Three sheets drunk, I mean decent people are working, they're still out drinking. Outside they heard the sound of a church bell ringing and saw a hearse bringing a fresh corpse for a funeral. The bartender saw it too, and that's when the news broke. It's someone you know, the bartender told him. There must have been a bad batch of something someone sold him, cause yesterday he was here just like having a beer, and death took him while he sat in his chair. Fucking weird. I guess death is the only unbeatable enemy, so we all better be ready to meet him eventually. The main thug took a swill of a bottle full of bravado and went all Robert Rodriguez desperado, like, that's disrespect. I'm sick of death. You rock a bulletproof vest, shit, he'll get you for cigarettes. I'm freaking vexed. You say I'll never defeat him, I say let's go find him. Fuck it, I'm ready to meet him. The violence in me reflect the violence that's around me, so I say if death wants beef, he found beef.
I'd rather go toe-to-toe with all of y'all.
I guess he thought death was a person. Silly thug, people get some funny ideas when they're really drunk. The other two guys were like, an eye for an eye, we in this together, son, your beef is mine. And that was it. Three drunk, angry men stumbled out the door looking to capture death, but they didn't get far. They met this old guy in the forest who looked like he was repping the dark side of the force on the Death Star. I mean, bags under his bloodshot eyes like Charlie Sheen after hitting the meth hard. Cracked skin like leather, frail and decrepit, his whole body wrapped in dirty rags like a leper. The old man waved and said, hey, what's the word? You guys look kinda lost, can I help you get somewhere? The main thug answered back like, ugh, don't touch me, you're covered in crusty scabs, it's disgusting, I think you better tell us how you're even still alive. And the old man replied, hey, I'm ready to die. I've been knocking on heaven's door since I was 75. I guess death just isn't ready to let me inside. And that's when the second thug stepped in like, shut up, death is your friend and you're trying to protect him from us. I can smell a setup, so tell us where he is. Either you're with us or you're with the terrorist. And the old man laughed like, what, you looking for death? Well then that's what you'll get. Death is right over there, really, go see. I just left him like 2 minutes ago under that oak tree. The thugs ran full speed, and when they arrived at the tree, they just stared with bulging eyes. Death wasn't there, just a bag full of money, stacks of 50s and 100s, handfuls of 20s. Suddenly, looking for death was forgotten. The main thug started scheming and plotting and slick talking. He said, listen, I'm a clever man, I hatch plots, and I can tell you, this much money attracts cops. We need to get it back to the stash spot, you feeling me? But transporting this by day, liability. Let's do this right, y'all. We wait for nightfall, and then we bring it home and split it up with the lights off. And after that, we can spend it. But for now, we just chill. So we need some booze, right? We got hours to kill. Let's draw straws, two of us could stand guard, and we'll send the third man off to get a bottle of cab sauv. The plan sounded damn suave. The youngest pulled the bad straw and ran off, and as soon as he was gone, the main thug went on like, aye, listen up, I'm about to get you paid. What would you say if I told you we could split this up two ways? Are you game? The second thug said, okay, but hold up, wait, what about our friend? What are we supposed to tell him? Know what I'm saying? We don't say nothing, said the first. We play rough and straight rush him and stick a knife in his side. I ain't bluffing. If we could bring him down, then we'll be kingpins and never have to think about income again. The second thug shrugged like, an eye for an eye, we in this together, son, your beef is mine. Well, in the meantime, the youngest was walking back thinking, god damn, I want all that cash. If I split it with those chumps, all I get is a third of it. Nah, I'm gonna murder those two fucking invertebrates. This isn't a game, this is a blood sport. So first he hit the liquor store, and then he hit the drug store, and he told the pharmacist, I got some rats in my basement, I need some poison so I can set some traps and waste them. And pretty soon he was walking back to the money tree with three bottles of wine, two poison and one clean. And what happened next? Exactly what I said. His two backstabbing friends stabbed him to death without a shred of remorse. The main thug said, hey yo, let's have a quick drink before we get rid of the corpse. And he grabbed a bottle, and he took a long swallow, and he passed it over to the second thug to follow. And it was all over. They went from boasting and bragging to drinking rat poison cocktails, choking and gagging, and no one was left standing. They all died, triple homicide, like a Biggie Smalls rhyme. Three friends looking for death, headstrong, murder one another for cash, dead wrong. Get rich or die trying, ask 50 he knows, like several plot lines of Quentin Tarantino's. Get the C-notes, get the G's, yo, the Benjamins, that street ethos you get from medieval Belgians. See, people don't change, you're all corrupted, fallen. That's why y'all need spiritual sustenance, guidance, you know, like the kind I provide. A ticket to heaven for $9.95. You like sex and violence? Just buy my record. It provides the whole essence of the Bible's message. Just like Kanye West, Jesus walked with him. That's a multi-platinum gangster gospel record. See, you feed your soul and your bank balance replenishes. So open your wallets up for heaven's representatives. That's why I wrote this rap, to help you get your soul back in return for cold cash. So don't hold back, don't even hold back 1 cent. That's the only way you can avoid becoming part of the 1%. Look, I know you're lost and all you want is redemption. Well, you can have it for a small cost by accepting a pardoner's blessing. So step forward, money ready, and accept the blessing. God told me it's my destiny to be rich, just like Pastor Rick Warren, or like Deepak Chopra, or like that chick who wrote The Secret. Look, you're taking a risk either way. Either you risk a few dollars, or you risk your soul.